This piece of ancient plant matter kick-started an era of us messing majorly with our planet. Of course, the most logical way of stopping that is burning less of this and other fossil fuels. But that's not happening nearly fast enough. Enter the carbon tax.
An alluringly simple idea. Just put a price tag on carbon emissions that are destroying our planet. The more you pollute, the more you pay, leading in theory to less pollution and making cleaner alternatives more appealing. Almost 30 countries worldwide have a form of it.
So can a carbon tax stop us from polluting?
But first things first, why are we focusing on carbon?
That's because as soon as we burn this, it becomes the biggest troublemaker.
When you burn coal, it emits vast amounts of CO2. The same goes for oil and gas. Carbon emissions from fossil fuels are by far the biggest pollutant that's responsible for climate change. This is regular air, and this is what we're doing to our atmosphere right now. And once we turn on our sun, this one starts heating up much quicker. A little bit of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is great, because carbon dioxide is really, really good at absorbing and radiating the heat that gets reflected from the Earth's surface. It's what makes our planet warm enough to live on.
But we're taking it a little bit too far with all of this.
We're blowing more of the stuff into the air almost every year. The only two dips you can see here, the 2009 financial crisis and the COVID-19 pandemic. Not exactly intentional and pretty catastrophic.
But the carbon tax ideally would change that. Make things that pollute a lot more expensive so that people will buy or use less of it. And in turn, this will make cleaner technologies cheaper and more attractive. It's so appealing because it seems so simple and logical.
It drives the lowest cost ways of reducing emissions.
Simon Tudiver works for the Canadian government. It's had a form of federal carbon tax since 2019.
And it just sort of sends a broad signal to the marketplace that pollution shouldn't be free. And then it kind of lets all of the actors decide for themselves how best that works in their businesses and in their lives.
27 countries and many more regions and cities have a carbon tax. It all started, unsurprisingly, with the Scandinavians. Finland, Norway, and Sweden, as well as Poland, first introduced carbon taxes in the early 90s. Since then, many countries have joined the club. But the reality of a carbon tax is more complex than some economists might think.
There are many different ways to tax carbon emissions.
You could tax the entire economy or just a specific sector. Some taxes only target companies of a certain size. A lot of the carbon taxes worldwide are taxes on fossil fuels. That means fossil fuel firms must pay for every liter or cubic meter of oil, gas, and coal they extract. But in many cases, the additional cost is passed on to the consumer, incentivizing them to use less of it.
The next question is what to do with all the money you just collected.
One way is to reduce other taxes.
In Sweden, one has called this the green tax shift.
This is Christian Thoman. He advised the Swedish government on tax policies for 10 years.
One used an increase in environmental taxation to reduce the taxes on labor. That would be considered to be a growth-enhancing reform.
Switzerland uses 2/3 of its revenue to reduce health insurance and social security payments and invests the rest into low-emission sectors. Canada takes it one step further.
Revenue we collect from that federal fuel charge, the vast majority of that is returned directly to individuals and households through lump sum payments. And so it's really designed to help with the affordability of carbon pricing overall.
And that idea of redistribution doesn't have to stay within one country.
If it were spread out globally, the richer nations could give the collected taxes to the countries of the global south, which are much less responsible for climate change but are hit the hardest. A global carbon tax would make that possible. A good idea in theory, but...
If you've ever heard anything about climate negotiations, you know that getting everybody to agree to a set tax rate is going to be really difficult. But there is another way of pricing carbon that needs to be mentioned. It's called emissions trading.
This means putting a cap on the amount of CO2 certain industries can emit. A company that exceeds that limit must buy extra allowances or will face penalties. If a company emits less, they can sell those allowances to other companies. This is supposed to ensure that the entire industry stays within the designated limit. The EU, for example, has a system like this in place. The same goes for China, Indonesia, and Mexico. Together, carbon taxes and emissions trading systems already cover around a quarter of all carbon emissions worldwide.
So that's the theory, but do they work in practice? There are many, many studies out there that try to answer this question.
Jessica Green looked at 37 of them for her own meta study.
Carbon pricing is both emissions trading systems and carbon taxes are associated with small reductions in emissions.
0 to 2% to be exact. Not a lot, but not nothing either. In single regions, it can be significantly more. Like in British Columbia, Canada, where according to this study, emissions fell by 5 to 15% in 7 years. The same goes if you look at single industries. This study estimated that the carbon tax may have reduced UK power sector emissions by up to 26%.
Whether a carbon tax works or not depends on how high it is. That means how much money you have to pay per ton of emitted carbon dioxide.
A metric ton of CO2 is what a one-way flight from New York to Paris emits per passenger, or the emissions produced driving some 4,000 kilometers with an average car, or burning over 900 of these coal briquettes. Uruguay had the highest carbon tax rate in 2023, followed by many European countries. But the tax rate rapidly falls to less than $20 for many nations.
Most carbon taxes are set up to become more expensive with time to deter future investment. Economists and policymakers have fought for years to find out how expensive a carbon tax has to be to work. But they agree on one thing: the prices right now are far too low.
A carbon tax is thought to only take effect upwards of 60 to 100 euros per ton, meaning right now most countries are not taxing carbon enough at all.
Another worry about putting a price on carbon is that if one country decides to introduce a tax, the companies will just go abroad. One of the ways to prevent that is good old tariffs.
That's what the EU is doing. If you want to import carbon-intensive goods like cement, iron and steel, or electricity, for example, you need to pay a carbon tariff. There are also proposals to expand that idea further. Countries that introduce a way of pricing carbon, whether it's a tax or emissions trading, could form a group that then gets better trade conditions. These so-called climate clubs could incentivize other countries to join in and start putting a price on emissions.
So basically, there is an opening. So you would both offer the carrot and the stick.
Arguably, the biggest hurdle, though, is political opposition. You're not going to win elections by raising or even introducing new taxes. Quite the opposite.
The low prices that we see for both carbon taxes and ETSs is a feature. It's not a bug. Politicians and policymakers are afraid to make carbon emissions more expensive because they will be punished at the polls.
One way around that is to reduce other expenses, like in Sweden or Switzerland. Another is tax rebates, like in Canada.
Setting the price of carbon low at first and then only gradually increasing it is also key.
But even then, carbon taxes can be extremely contentious, as seen here in Canada. Even still, countries like Indonesia, Morocco, and Senegal are planning or considering a carbon tax. Brazil, Malaysia, Vietnam, Nigeria, and others are doing the same with emissions trading systems. Overall, the share of emissions covered by carbon pricing has been rising steadily.
If you're talking to a developing country, maybe a national carbon tax will allow the country to develop. It's not as difficult to implement as an emission trading system. If you're talking about more developed countries. I would say that their emission trading system might be more appealing.
The question is whether enacting a carbon tax or setting up a trading system is worth the political fight and the bureaucratic effort that comes with it. That may depend a lot on the country, and opinions are split on this.
Sometimes those political and communications challenges can seem overwhelming, but I think in the Canadian context, we can show that we've been able to implement an effective functioning system.
I think if we're going to dedicate time and resources to fighting the climate crisis, then we need to do it in ways that are direct government interventions through things like technology standards, subsidies, incentives, the types of green industrial policy that we're increasingly seeing in Europe.
If, after considering all of the above, a country still does decide to go with a carbon tax, there are a few things to consider. Overall carbon tax rates need to be set higher than they are right now. Lower-income households must be protected from the knock-on effects. You need to find a way to make it appealing to citizens through rebates or tax breaks elsewhere. Industries that are hard to move abroad and are not that exposed to international competition, like transportation, for example, are easier to target first. A carbon tax is by far not as simple and effective as it sounds at first, and it can be more trouble than it's worth. It alone won't solve the problem, but putting a price on pollution is a step in the right direction.
Does your country have a carbon tax? Please let us know in the comments and subscribe. We post videos like this every Friday.